to welcome anyone online who might be visiting with us online or drive up worship. Today, as you can see, we have the Reverend Linda Pitts behind me, and she is currently the Parish Associate at Faith Presbyterian, as we also be having communion today. We do have a few announcements, actually a lot of announcements. On Ash Wednesday, coming up on the 22nd at 5 p.m., we'll be having service here. Remember to put your meet and eat groups, purple forms. You can leave them in the narthex, fill them out, or you can put them in the offering tray if you'd like. The Scout Sunday, which had been planned, has been postponed due to scheduling conflicts. There will also be a session meeting this Tuesday night, February 21st at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall. Agendas are in the mailboxes if you are an elder. We do have some joys and concerns we need to let you know about. Gene Brenson is recovering from eye surgery. Had good news for Ann Loge, but we're going to back it up a little bit. She does have some health issues, and she has tested positive for COVID. Patty Dickman is having balance and health issues. Also from Faith Kinnear, Margot Armistead, who has not been feeling well. Also, Patty Dickman asked us to play for the family of Donna Downing, who passed away last week. Ken Norman is having continuing health issues. And we also ask you to pray for the family of Serena, her mother who fell recently causing a fracture, and her brother who is also having health issues. Do we have any other joys and concerns? Joys and concerns that anyone would like to share with us.
Thank you.
us call ourselves to worship. Exalt the Lord our God and worship it. Worship at God's holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy.
Come into God's presence with thanksgiving.
Let us worship God. Now in body or in spirit, let us stand for our hymn, Awesome God.
Thank you.
thanksgiving, let us share our tithes and offerings with the Lord.
Nice thing to be here on the Lord's Day. It's good to see your smiling faces, and I'm just happy to be back. Let us pray. Oh God, open our eyes and our ears, open our hearts and our minds to hear your word as it is read and as it is proclaimed. Help us to hear what you would have us to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. So now let us listen for a word from the Lord. I'm reading from Matthew, the 17th chapter, verses 1 through 13. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings, here one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." And the disciples asked him, Why then do the scribes say that Elijah must come first?" And he replied, "Elijah is indeed coming and will restore all things. But I tell you that Elijah has already come, and they did not recognize him, but they did to him whatever they pleased. So also the Son of Man is about to suffer at their hands." Then the disciples understood that he was speaking to them about John the Baptist. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There are several shows on television, primarily on the HGTV channel, but there are other channels as well, where somebody can buy an old home and have it restored so that it'll become their perfect dream home. And one of these shows is Hometown. Aaron and Ben Napier are the hosts of that show. And what they do is they show a prospective buyer a couple of homes that need a little work, perhaps. And then the prospective buyer tells Ben and Aaron which one they want them to renovate. So it's interesting to watch how Erin shares the design plans and presents her vision for the home, which is typically well-loved and has been lived in. But it could possibly benefit from some refreshing, some improvements. And so that's why they're there. Now, the prospective buyers have to look past the things in the house that are less than perfect, perhaps. The stains in the carpet, the walls in the middle of a room, maybe the kitchen layout or bathroom layout or other things that just aren't quite right, and at least not to their liking. But they have to look past that in order to see the possibilities for what that house could become. And Erin shows the family what she thinks it could be if they move this wall or they move this window. Or maybe they paint the cabinets, or they put new floors, or paint, any number of things, depending on their budget. Erin shows them what could be. Now, as the show goes through the renovation, the plan, they explain this plan fairly quickly. And I always wonder, does the family really understand what they're about to get? Maybe they do, maybe they don't. But when she asks them, "What do you think?" typically they say, "Oh, that'll be beautiful." But every now and then there's somebody, a buyer, who can't see past the hole in the floor. They can't see past the chartreuse paint in the kitchen, or the toilet that doesn't work, or there's a wall blocking the view of the backyard. And so they tell Erin, "Well, I really can't see your vision, but I'll just have to trust you." In the end, after the renovation is complete, the buyers are always amazed and pleased. And they have made all of the renovations that have been done. And they say things like, "This is better than I could have ever imagined. And it doesn't even look like the same house." Sometimes we can only see what's in front of us. We have difficulty visualizing what might be, difficulty seeing it any other way. Sometimes we can only see the what is or the what has been and not the what could be. We can't always see the possibilities that are hidden inside. In order to see possibilities, we have to look at things in a new way. Now, the gospel writer tells us about an event where three disciples were selected to see Jesus in a new way, in a way that they hadn't before. It was an unusual and unexpected event. And And I can believe that they were probably a little bit scared and confused and probably didn't understand quite what was happening when Jesus was transfigured before their very eyes. Now they knew Jesus, their teacher and friend, Jesus the carpenter from Nazareth, Jesus who taught them about God and performed miracles and changed their lives. They hadn't seen Jesus in this way, radiating life from every part of his body. They hadn't seen Jesus as divine. They knew this wasn't something that happened every day. Now, they had seen many, many miracles that defied any kind of explanation. And they kind of came to expect that from Jesus. But this was different. This was special. This was a special and powerful experience. Now, Peter, James, and John saw Jesus in a new way. They knew him as their teacher and their leader and their friend. They knew him as a man, as a human. But now they saw Jesus was more than that. Jesus was divine. And to confirm what the experience meant, they heard God's voice from the heavens saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." I'm reminded of the time when Peter made his pronouncement about who Jesus is. And in the 16th chapter of Matthew, Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And the disciples said, "Some say you're Elijah, maybe Jeremiah, or another prophet." And then Jesus asked, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter declared, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus tells him, "Blessed are you, son of Jonah. For this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood. This was revealed to you by my Father in heaven." Peter didn't just think that up all on his own. It was revealed to him by God. Just as God revealed Jesus' divinity on the mountain that day to Peter, James, and John. As I read this passage, I kept thinking about how God shared this incredible revelation about who Jesus is with these three disciples. It was something only God could reveal. And it helped them to see and understand Jesus in ways that they could not on their own. Likewise, God shares revelations with us today and helps us to see what God needs us to see in the way that God sees it. For instance, in our interactions and relationships with others, we often don't see and know everything there is to know about the other person. Rather, we may only see what's on the surface or what that person wants us to see. And what we see and understand about the other person may be based solely on our first impression. Or it may be based on experiences that we've observed from the past. Unfortunately, these ways of gathering information are somewhat limited because they're limited by our biases and our perceptions and our own experiences. They can't truly show us everything there is to know about the person who is with us, the person who we're talking to. But thankfully, God sees what we cannot see and can show us what we need to see. It is therefore important that we keep our focus on God and be intentional about seeking God and listening and watching for what God is revealing to us. Each day we come into contact with a variety of people, all of whom we may know on some level, but when we meet them, we see only what's on the outside. We don't see what they believe. We don't see what their character is unless we have a chance to talk to them and watch their behaviors. Psychology today tells us that it takes 7 seconds to form a first impression, and our impressions are based on a number of characteristics. The article also notes that we often get attached to our first impressions. and we have a hard time changing our opinions. That's something to think about. I wonder how well we know the people in our lives, and if there are those for whom we have formed opinions or made judgments without really knowing everything there is to know about them or their situation. Let me give you a couple of examples to think about. Suppose someone comes to the church who may look different than the other folks who are in the congregation. Maybe it appears that they don't have a place that they can call home. Or maybe it's difficult to understand when they speak. Or maybe they don't seem to follow the order of worship or understand the service and what is happening. I wonder what kind of impression we form about them. And how do we respond to them? Do we keep our distance? Do we judge them by their appearance or their actions? Do we judge them by their differences? Or do we see the person that God wants us to see and the person that God is trying to show us? Do we see who they are in God's eyes and care for them as a child of God, as a brother or sister in Christ? Do we welcome them, talk to them, and try to get to know them better? We may not know them at first, but if we see them as a child of God, someone that God loves, we know there is more to them than meets the eye. There's something that we need to get to know them better. Now, Mother Teresa speaks of seeing Jesus in the people that she helps and that she meets. Even in the most difficult and helpless and hopeless situations, Jesus. I think that's a good practice. And that helps us to keep our focus on Jesus and helps us to have more caring and positive interactions with people. It helps us to discover the goodness in each person. So let me challenge you a little bit with some other characteristics, other situations and people that we might benefit from seeing in a new way, seeing them the way that God sees them. What about people who we don't like? You really don't want to be around them. What about somebody who harms others? Someone who has killed someone, someone who abuses. What about someone who thinks and says hateful things toward others? What about people with whom we disagree philosophically and politically and theologically? People with whom we can almost not have a conversation without arguing. Now, how does God want us to feel about these people? Does God expect us to care for them and help them and treat them with dignity and kindness? Now, you might be saying, whoa, I don't like where this is going. Are you asking me to love my neighbor, even if my neighbor is my enemy? The answer is yes, even if it's hard. Maybe especially if it's hard. Corrie ten Boom, you may know who that is, was a Christian living in the Netherlands during World War II, and she was imprisoned at a Nazi concentration camp more than once. And after the war was over and after she was released, she tells a story of seeing one of the Nazi officers from one of the concentration camps where she was imprisoned. She talks about how cruel he was, the cruel acts that he performed, the evil actions that he did. Now, she was a guest speaker at an event in Munich where she spoke on forgiveness. It was there that she saw him. And after her presentation, he approached her. Though he didn't remember her, there were so many people, he did not remember her, but she remembered him. He reached out to shake her hand and to thank her for her words. But at that moment, she could not bring herself to shake his hand. And he told her that since the time of when he was a guard, after that time had passed, that he had become a Christian. He told her that he knew that God had forgiven him for all the cruel things that he did. But he would also like to have her forgiveness. She said she stood there. She knew her sins had been forgiven again and again, but she could not forgive. She wrestled with the most difficult thing she had ever had to do. She said, "Jesus, help me." She prayed silently. "I can lift my hand. I can do that much. You supply the feeling." And she said she thrust her hand into his outstretched hand. And as she did, an incredible thing took place. The current started in her shoulder, ran down her arm, sprang into their joined hands. And then a feeling of warmth seemed to flood her whole being, bringing tears to her eyes. And she said, "I forgive you, brother, with my whole heart." She cried. That was God at work. And it probably doesn't get much more challenging than that, I think. Now, Miss Ten Boom knew God's teachings, and she trusted God completely. God had been with her through her time in the concentration camp. She trusted God, especially in this difficult moment. She knew the guard that stood before her. She knew him based on her negative experiences with him. And that's what she held on to. But God was showing her that this man, showing her a way to see him in a new way. Was changed, now a Christian, a new man, a new creation in Christ. The question she had to answer or consider was, how was she going to respond to what God was showing her? God works in similar ways in our lives, revealing what God wants us to see and helping us to do things that sometimes seem impossible. God is showing us that there is more to people than what we are able to see with our own less than perfect vision, which is filtered through our biases and our experiences. When we allow ourselves to see through God's eyes, we see the good God sees in the other imperfect people around us. Maybe when we look for the good in others, we'll find that we're not going to be judgmental as much, that we might be more tolerant. We might find that we're more willing to listen and to work together. And maybe we're going to be more merciful and forgiving if we see the good in others. And maybe we'll find that our relationships are deeper and stronger with each other, and especially deeper and stronger with God. Just as Jesus enabled Peter, James, and John to see Jesus in a new way, may God enable you to see people and situations in your life in new ways, ways that inspire and strengthen. God be the glory. Amen. And now as we approach the table, I'll let you know that the elders will be serving communion to you. They will be distributing the bread, and they'll distribute the cup. In the bread, we have the bread that is sliced into cubes, has fruit and nuts in its baking. There is a gluten-free, nut-free option in a cup on the tray. So if you would like that, just just let your elder know that it's serving you so that you may have that. Jesus invites each of us to this table. We're not perfect. We're far from it. We're flawed, and we need God's forgiveness. We need God's comfort. We need God's love. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." God is with us. We need not feel alone. For we're not alone. We need not fear, for God's love and grace surround us, and it is God who invites us to come. This table represents God's gift of love and life through the bread and the cup, as Jesus shared with his disciples in the upper room. It's not a Presbyterian table. It's not Lafayette's table. It is the Lord's table. And everyone who loves Jesus and wishes to know him better is invited to participate and partake of the gifts of God. Let us pray. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts and lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise today and each day for all you do and who you are. You are the creator of all that is, of this world, and all that we need. You have provided for us in spirit and in spite of our waywardness and our shortcomings. And you continue to love us still. Throughout time, you have sent your word to us through the prophets, the scriptures, the leaders of your church, and through your disciples past and present. You desire for us to be in relationship with you and to have what is best for us. Your love and providence are shared continually and abundantly. We thank you for your gift of your Son. In the fullness of time, you sent to earth your word, your incarnate Son, Jesus the Christ. He came as an infant, born of Mary, his mother, raised in an earthly family where he grew to adulthood. He taught us about you and how to live as you want us to live. He demonstrated love and compassion, mercy and forgiveness, and charged us to do the same. Jesus gave the ultimate gift of love and forgiveness when he gave his life for the forgiveness of our sins, that we might have eternal life. But the grave was not the end. Christ defeated death when he rose to life on the third day as promised. Jesus continues to be with us, teaching and caring for us, until the day when he comes again to usher in God's kingdom. As promised, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, our intercessor, advocate, companion, until Christ return. It is through your Spirit that we experience your presence in our lives, your guidance, your inspiration, your power, and your love. We praise you, Lord. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and juice, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory to you, O God, now and forever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was arrested, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take
given for you, the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, which is shed for the remission of sins. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim our Lord and Savior's death and resurrection until he comes again. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The table is ready. Let us partake together. Thank you.
God, we thank you for feeding us with your meal, the food of life. Let it strengthen us that we may strive faithfully and without fear through each day, knowing that you are moving right in step with us, guiding us through everything that lies ahead. Our lives are full of blessings from you. We do not deserve your outpouring of love and caring, but you give it freely. We long to live our lives in ways that praise you, yet we find it hard to do sometimes. Help us to follow where you lead and guide us back when we stray. Jesus showed us great love for his disciples, even when they doubted, when they made mistakes, and when they turned away. Jesus restored Peter after he had denied him, and he called Peter to love and care for his flock. And Peter went forward, courageously doing as Jesus said. Likewise, we are called to care for your flock. Give us strength and courage to lovingly lead and care for others as Jesus does. Let us be an example of your love to all people. Help us to care in our world and show care for the community and all we meet. We see so much negativity and cruelty in our world. Help us to share hope and kindness, even when it's not shown to us. We lift up those who struggle with their health or the pain of loss. We pray for their healing and strength, for their comfort and peace. Help us to show your love and compassion to them. They might know they're not alone. And we pray for all those who deal with fear and doubt and despair in their lives. Help them to know that they are not alone, that you are with them, loving and restoring them. Open our eyes to see their needs and show us how we can be of help. Now join our hearts and voices together as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
just know that God is going to help you through each situation, even if it feels like it's impossible. Now may you be a blessing to others as God has blessed you, and pass that on to each person you meet.
Yes.